Everyone, welcome to another episode of First Canada Live. We are back and we're here doing good stuff today. We got a great show. This is a show where we kind of talk about what's going on in the First community, all the good stuff that's happening. We talk to some of our alumni, some of our volunteers, some of our teams, and we got all sorts of good stuff happening today. But first, I'd like to introduce our co-host for today. He is a First alum, Ontario District Head Referee, and Ontario MC, Drive Coach for Team 3683, Team Dave. Hey, Pranit, how's it going?
Hello, 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 everyone. Hi, Karthik. It's going great. How are you doing, man?
Good to be back on the show. Yeah, it's great to have you. We were on as a Storytime guest before, so glad to have you here as a co-host. Also, just, you know, because, you know, in First, you support everyone. You support everything that's going on in the community. So we're supporting our Blue Jays right now, who are playing right now in the bottom of the sixth inning, down 1-0. But who knows? Things can change. But we have lots of stuff happening here on the show. Pranit, have you seen like the lineup of guests we have? Because it's pretty cool.
Dude, I'm so excited for the future, for the Jays game and for what we have lined up for the show.
And we have we have teams 1305 and 2056 talking about their upcoming conferences. We got two students from each team. We got Storytime with the First Canada Volunteer Coordinator, Kaushal, Kapasi. And we have Storytime with First Canada Head Ref. We're going to have like a little head ref discussion here. So, you know, we can ask some specific reffing questions, get some good reffing stories out of the two of you. But we have Matt Glanfield here as well. So that's going to be a blast. If you got questions throughout the show, feel free to just drop them into the Twitch chat. And we'll try our best to address them here. And remember what we're here for. We're here to celebrate the excellence and the awesomeness in the First community. So let's try and spread some positivity, spread some good energy, and some good vibes with everything that we're posting on social. So before we get started with all our awesome guests, I think it's time to go over some of the news updates. And there's been a lot going on in the First community. Last week, there was so we got our first kickoff chat coming up, FLL kickoff, and it's going to be a really good time. This Saturday, October 3rd, there's going to be conferences going on. And then throughout the week, October 15th through 9th, we have more seminars. So Pranit, did you do FLL when you were in elementary school?
Unfortunately, I moved to Canada just for high school, so I didn't get a chance to, but I was part of hosting the events at Woburn Collegiate, my high school, throughout my high school years. And I even went back as a judge a few times. So I've been to a few FLL events myself. And let me tell you, they're about as exciting as they get. The kids, the parents, the energy all around is just fantastic.
Yeah, and so like looking at these conferences, Pranit, there's like a lot of interesting sessions. What's the one session you'd be interested in going to?
I think like personally speaking, I've spent, you know, every single year that I've been in Canada in FRC. So if I was a young student, I would want to know about the teams. I would want to know like meeting the teams and getting to know their perspective on how the competitions are and what they get out of it. If I'm a parent, I would like to like watch with my kid to just understand, hey, like what is my kid getting into and how this can help them throughout their lives, not just, you know, at the time to meet new people, but it's a really, really good platform to develop like some like social interaction skills as well as technical skills.
Yeah, and with these conferences, you know, there's going to be technical workshops, you know, on programming a robot, building a robot, but there's workshops on ED&I and some of the other skills, you know, how to run a team. And so there's a lot of challenges going on with FLL, so this is going to be really good. So October 3rd, right here on this Twitch channel, and then go to the First Canada website, click on the tile for FLL kickoff to learn about how to attend all those other workshop webinars, which is going to be really fun. Other news, and this is the big news that I started talking about at the top, is that there was an update from First Headquarters last week about what the season is going to look like. And they made some pretty big announcements. And one of them is that First is planning for not only, you know, putting aside the physical sort of stuff that we typically do, but they're going to have some virtual challenges available for all the teams this year. They have a game design challenge where you can design a game, which who knows, it could even be used possibly as an FRC game in the future. That's right. The Global Innovation Challenge, which has been such a big part of the FLL and FTC community, is now coming to FRC. So, you know, you think about the STEMathon that First Canada put on this summer, where students were given a big problem to try and solve. That's kind of a little bit what like Global Innovation is like, but just on a bigger scale and a more expanded time format. And also, the awards this year are going to go virtual. So instead of presenting directly to judges in person at an event, you're going to be doing these online sort of Zoom presentations. So Pranit, like looking at this, and you know, you're a mentor for a team, and you know, you were a student, so you have like a lot of different perspectives. Which of these online challenges kind of excite you the most?
I mean, I think it's a tough time It's been a tough year for everyone globally speaking. And I think FIRST has made a great decision to find like a happy middle ground, to find a way to make sure people can still compete. The program still carries on, but in a safe manner. So I'm thankful for that as a competitor. And I feel like from a competitor perspective, I think the game design challenge and the innovation challenge presented by Qualcomm specifically, they'll give the students and the teams a really cool insight into the background workings of game design, because year after year, like, you know, I've competed in 13 different unique games now. And every year, like, I'm always amazed by like what people at the GDC come up with. And now it's going to be interesting to see the teams with a fresh new look, in the sense that like these are people who don't really have a set of rules to work with. So it'll be cool to see some outside the box thinking, so to speak. And the innovation challenge presents like it's a whole new thing where I competed in something called like Formula One in schools back when I was in high school, and it's a similar challenge where you give you a set of rules and you're presenting the team not as an engineering challenge, but you're presenting it as like a business challenge. Along with some engineering aspect involved in it. So I think that's going to be really cool. It just changes up how you compete in FRC for 2021. And they are truly force for change and changing the games. That's cool.
That's right. The other part of the announcement was FIRST Headquarters announced that, you know, right now events are kind of on hold, but they're going to revisit that decision in January. And FIRST Canada is going to be doing the exact same thing in the process. So behind the scenes, like, we're doing everything we can, you know, to hope that we can, you know, get to events in the spring, you know, but we have to make sure that it's absolutely safe and there's approval from health experts, government, FIRST, you know, all together in that. But we're all going to be together this. But in the meantime, these challenges are really awesome. These challenges will be kicking off at kickoff. Pranit, did you know that FIRST Canada has their own set of challenges coming out next week?
Whoa, tell me more about that.
It's called the Recharge Your Bot Challenges. And actually, Pranit, you haven't heard about any of this, but I think you're going to enjoy some of these, because it's 6 different challenges, each where you submit a 1-minute long video. And we're going to go, I don't want to go into all the details today, because we're doing that next week. We're going to be doing the unveiling. But like, Pranit, are you a fan of Dude Perfect?
Dude, that guy's nuts. I love it. The energy he brings to the video, it's so crazy.
Imagine if FIRST Teams had to make videos like that, doing trick shots with their robot.
Saying. I don't know if we can do this safely, but I think we can get KPNB production back online and get some stuff going.
Oh, KPNB
right?
production.
Right, you know.
All right. We're going to have to call up Noreen and Banshul for that. That'll be good. But like, if you've got video making skills, you've got TikTok skills, robot reels, whatever, tune in next week to learn about that. But also, Pranit, there is, have I ever lied to you, my friend?
Not to my knowledge.
We got a major announcement coming on, but we can't tell you all the details, but it's a major announcement affecting all on FRC, all FIRST programs in Ontario, FRC, FLL, FTC next week. You're not going to want to miss this one. It's a super major announcement. We cannot give you any more details right now, but tune in next week to FIRST Canada Live to hear more. And it's like, it's going to be big. I think everyone's going to be excited to hear about it. So that's going to be really cool. Are you going to tune in?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You're dangling so much bait. How can I not?
Like... Exactly. Well, that's what we do. We dangle stuff. But we got some cool stuff to dangle about some upcoming conferences. So let's talk about that in just a few seconds. All right, now it's time to talk about these upcoming conferences. When we're talking about virtual events, we've got virtual conferences going on too. So let's please welcome our four guests, starting off with Emily F., Team 2056 student, Ontario Dean's List semifinalist last year, member of the FIRST Canada Youth Council, and a producer on FIRST Canada Live and the student lead for the 2056 Ways to Inspire Conference. We also have Samantha P., Team 2056 student lead of the 2056 Ways to Inspire Conference. Hey, Emily. Hey, Samantha. And we have Colton C., Team 1305 2020 Ontario Dean's List finalist. Congratulations again, Colton. And this one of the student co-leads for the FIRST Gateway Conference. And of course, we have Michelle D., Team 1305, and another FIRST Canada Youth Council member, and also a student co-lead for the FIRST Gateway Conference. So hello, everyone. How are you all doing?
Hi.
Good.
We're super excited to have you here. You're all in blue shirts. You know, we're like one fancy alliance here. It's the conference alliance. What up? This is good. Pranit, can you referee this little alliance
here? Yeah, that's why I'm not in blue. I'll ref, not that I got the memo or anything about blue.
We only have a short amount of time here, but we do want to hear what everyone has to say about their conferences. So can each of you give us a rundown on what to expect at your conferences? Who's going to be speaking, what other topics, and anything else? Let's start off with Team 1305.
We got a really exciting lineup ready for everybody, Karthik. Where you can find all the information. We've got our agenda all set on the team1305.org, our team website. But we're going to have an amazing MC. You might have heard of her. She's Sydney Lamoria. She's a first alum, and she's a great MC at first competitions as well. Super energetic.
She's been on First Canada Live before, and no one was the MC at provincials the last couple of years. Superstar.
Yeah. So she's going to be the MC, and we've got plenty of awesome speakers lined up as well. We've got a robot analysis panel with teams 610, 771, 7480, and 1305. And we've got pharmacy doctor Richard Percunier, who will be doing a presentation on the role of robots in medicine. So those are a couple of the presentations on Friday, because this is actually a two-day event on October 16th and October 17th. So we're actually going to let everybody sleep in until 10 o'clock before the opening ceremony.
Oh, that's lovely. That's lovely.
Yeah, and we'll have some more awesome presentations. We're going to have Karthik is going to be joining us. Yeah. Is this, are you just hearing about this, Karthik?
No, I've heard. I'm trying to act surprised. I'm trying to make a bit. I'm well aware. Colton's been emailing me about this for the past few weeks, and I'm really excited to be a part of this conference. But this is one of the cool things about going virtual with an event, because normally, the 1305 conference, it's not close by. It's not something I can easily get to. But now virtually, I can do it from, right here in this seat. And so I'm pumped to be a part of it.
What about you, Emily and Samantha? What about your conference? Tell us about that.
Yeah, so our conference is actually as soon as this weekend, October 3rd and 4th. If you go to our website, 2056.ca, you'll see a big banner at the top. It says the 26th Ways to Inspire Conference. Well, you can find it'll be streamed on the Twitch, which is the Twitch channel is FRC 2056. And it'll be all day, both days, with some amazing speakers. We have an ED&I and FIRST panel by the FIRST EDI Youth Advisory Council. We have the FIRST Youth Council coming on. We have Mr. John Hobbins talking about FRC 2021. And we have a lot of other really amazing things, and the schedule's up on their website as well, so you guys can check that out as well.
That's exciting. I've attended a few of those conferences in person myself over the past few years. And let me tell you, if everyone watching this or watching the VOD later on, if you guys get a chance, definitely sign up and check it out. There's a boatload of information, and you can always check out their stuff later on their website too. Tell us something about, what's unique about your conference compared to other, meet and greets or team things that go on. Tell us a little bit about how it differs from an actual event.
Well, since it's online, kind of as Karthik said, we can get a lot more people from a lot farther away. And at our conference, we have a special guest appearance from a couple of local superheroes. So if you guys wanted to see what that's all about, you should come join us at our conference.
So,
yeah.
So local superheroes like Iron Man?
Oh, even better than Iron Man.
I guess for the North, it could be Nickel Man. Get it?
Oh, no.
Come on, yeah.
Oh no.
Or even better, it could be Nickelback. This is how you remind me.
I want my Nickelback for that joke.
I really am. Okay, I'll stop. Pretty, take it away.
Look, it's time to move on to the next part when Karthik starts singing. So thankfully.
But seriously though, there's been a lot of these conferences over the years. I think we've all had a chance to attend them. So Samantha, when you've attended, whether it be the 2056 conference or other conferences, what's been one of the favorite things that you've seen?
Well, one of my favorite things is just getting to connect with members of the FRC community and robotics community in general. And although we don't have in-person events this year, I think there's still going to be awesome opportunities to do that virtually. And just being able to share knowledge with people of all different ages and different levels of STEM experience is definitely my favorite part.
What about you, Colton? What's your favorite thing at a conference like this, whether it be in-person or virtual?
I think it's a really great way to meet new people. There's people from different teams coming together and learning about all things FRC and things maybe not related to FRC that are great things to know for the real world. I think they're also great learning opportunities as well.
I know for me at the 2056 conference is one of the most interesting conferences presentations I've attended. It was Tyler Holtzman usually does a 2056 ways to win, but I heard he's doing something a little bit different this year.
He's doing something very similar. It's called maximizing your on-field performance. Right. So similar, but not a different name from I understand.
It sounds like it's going to be really good. And Tyler is just like one of these experts in the community, but there's so much to learn from him. So, make sure you tune in and, get in that chat, ask him those types of questions that you just normally wouldn't get to. Because, when we're at events, everyone's so busy and like Tyler is just like in demand, dude. But now you have your chance to ask him any question you want. Like Pranit, if you could ask Tyler Holtzman any question, what would it be?
So over the past few years, my question is going to be like, are you going to pick me? That's kind of the question, usually I ask him. The last year kind of went pretty well, but in all seriousness, there's a lot of young, aspiring, designers and engineers out there. And he has a boatload of knowledge. He knows, he's been in the program for so long. Ask him technical questions, ask him how he interacts how he uses his experience at work or how he brings his experience from work and puts it into the robotics team, whether it's interacting with the students, getting the drive team going, designing the robot, whatever it may be. There's so much to learn and he'll be more than happy to answer all your questions, I'm sure.
I think that's cool about these two conferences. Look here, we got four rock star students in our FRC community here. And so I just want to know, this is people in the industry get paid tens of thousands of dollars to plan these sorts of big events. And now you're doing these as high school students. So what's that experience been like? Does anyone want to try taking that one on? Michelle?
Yeah. Well, it's been quite different. Reaching out and kind of cold calling or cold emailing people sometimes could be a little bit daunting. But I think I've kind of gotten the hang of it more and more as we've gone on. And yeah, it's a lot of work. But as I said, it's a lot of learning too. So almost being paid in learning experience, maybe you could say.
Well, for sure. Michelle, you put this on a resume, I organized a conference where there was X number of people who watched and this many impressions or whatever. That's huge stuff. And so, Emily, I know you've been working behind the scenes on this 2056 conference and, the hamster wheel has been spinning overdrive. What's been the coolest part of this process for you?
I think the coolest part is that I got to personally email all these people that I normally, because normally I'd just be helping out with this conference. And it's sort of cool because I've been able to personally email all these people and sort of been able to run this however I thought was best direction to run this, especially because earlier we realized very early that we weren't able to run it like normal. And we were able to sort of play with ideas on how we were going to run it differently than and make it so we can still reach out to just as many or even more people this year, while still being able to have our conference.
Fabulous, really, really exciting. So one question we have from the chat, and this applies for both conferences, so let each of you take a turn, but will these conference sessions be available to watch afterwards?
So ours will. We're going to record, I'm going to be recording them while they go on, and then we're going to post them like normal. So normally on our website, you'd go, if you go to our website, 26.ca, there's a little section that says conferences, and you can actually see all of our past year conferences have been recorded. And so we're going to plan to do the same thing with this year's conferences.
And what about for Colton and Michelle?
Yeah, ours will be as well. Be able to watch after the fact, if you couldn't make it.
Will that be on the... You'll be able to find it on the FRC Team 1305 YouTube channel once the conference is over. Everything will be recorded, and we'll put that up as soon as we can and probably make some social media posts to say, hey, go check it out if you missed it. People can watch it at their leisure when they want to.
Awesome. And so is there any, does your teams need to sign up in advance, or is there anything like that that needs to happen? Or could people, do people just tune in to the Twitch channel or however you're broadcasting it?
So for us, Colton, do you want, are you sure? Okay.
Yeah.
For us, no. So you don't have to sign up for anything. You can just drop in whenever you'd like to drop into our, it's just a normal Twitch stream, just like First Can Live is right now. So you can just drop in whenever you'd like to, leave whenever you'd like to. Yeah.
Our conference, we do require that you sign up at least for while the conference is happening. You can find that team1305.org. Once again, there's plenty of information there. If you want to go check out the other speakers, there's plenty more amazing speakers that we haven't had time to name. But there's also the sign up information is all there. And I believe we're going to be looking at some options for maybe a bit more participation.
Nice. And I mean, as you guys said, like, it's great. You guys are going to be posting the seminars and the videos on YouTube and on the team's websites. But, you know, like, obviously, it's as easy as it is to watch it in hindsight, so to speak. It would be great if people join in, and that way you can interact with the presenters and ask your questions right then and there and have a chance for them to be answered. So, you know, everyone watching, please tune in, check it out, ask your questions. I'm sure these four fine folk are going to be, you know, interacting with the people there as well. So that'll be cool.
So we got a little bit of extra time here. So I got questions, maybe not necessarily related to your conference, but just in general. So all four of you, you know, you're all back in school right now and, you know, doing school differently or whatever. So, you know, I want to ask, like, Samantha, what's it like now in school for a student like at OP? Like, what's going on?
Yeah, well, OP, the way our school is running is there's different options. So students can do remote learning from their homes, or they can go into class, and there's a system where they're there every other day, and they have one in-class lesson. And currently I'm doing remote learning, so I've just been at home. And I mean, it's definitely very different interacting with my teachers and fellow classmates through video calls and virtually. It's a very different experience, but overall it's been going well, and there's still lots of opportunities to get help and take time to go back and review lessons when you need them. So far it's been going well.
And have you, so, you know, obviously, like, being remote and kind of being at home, that's got to, it's different. Like, you know, for what I remember of high school, like, the social experience was like, you know, it was like the old Zach Morris line, I love high school, it's too bad classes get in the way. And so, you know, kind of being at home, have you found new ways to connect with your friends?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I know. Going into school every day, seeing your friends, especially with robotics, spending so much time with them, you get used to seeing them a lot. So doing virtual calls has been super important for us, keeping up. And then when we're able to, going on social distance walks, making sure we're staying safe and getting outside, that's been great as well. But staying connected is super important.
What about you, Colton? How are things going up north?
Things are good with 1305 as a community team. We've got students from a bunch of different schools, so everyone's a little bit different. Me personally, I've been back at school, and it's been really good to get back and be able to talk to people. And also, the team's been meeting a lot more. We kind of took a bit of a break over the summer to do some fun summer activities. And now that we're back in school, we're getting things organized for our conference and talking about more events after that.
All right. Well, we got one question from the chat here. I want each of you to take a turn with this one. But what are you looking forward to most in your conference? We'll start with Michelle.
Oh, wow. Well, I will be presenting on a panel. So that's kind of one of the first time things for me. So I'm really excited to kind of jump head first into that.
What's the topic? And,
presenting chairmans. Yes. Yeah. And, but I'm also really excited to see the robots in medicine part as well. I think that will be very interesting. And I know a lot of people, at least on our team, are really interested in being doctors as well. So kind of combining both, I think, would be really good, really cool.
Very exciting. What about you, Emily?
Really, really hard for me, I feel like. I'm really excited. I think I'm just really excited for this event in general, because it's been a little stressful and a little like hoping for the best with it still, and I'll be behind the scenes the whole time, so I think I'm just excited to see how it all plays out and see all the presenters and how that all works, and hope that it'll be a very exciting event.
Now, has that been a challenge for you, Emily, to be a little bit behind the scenes? Because, like, you know, you're such a visible and vocal member of Team 2056 and, you know, strong face in the community, like on First Canada Live and stuff. So what's it like being like 100% behind the scenes for the day?
I have been, as you know, I've been one of the producers for First Canada Live the last few weeks. And it's been, I feel like it's been like a lot of fun for me to see how other people present and sort of be in charge of some of the behind the scenes stuff. I do sometimes miss the being upfront stuff, like right now, because I've always liked doing this sort of stuff, but it's nice taking a look behind the scenes, and it sort of has gained me respect for all the producers and how hard the jobs really are to be sitting behind the scenes. So yeah.
Yeah, I mean, well, just in general, thank you to everyone who does stuff behind the scenes, especially on First Canada Live. We got our producers, Artie and Sarah, working really hard right now. We got our moderators in chat doing good stuff. So yeah, behind youth, the scenes is fun. It's kind of cool.
And our youth council producer, Mahak, today.
Yeah, right. We got a whole crew of people. So what about you, Colton? What are you looking forward to?
Like Michelle said, I'm really looking forward to the robots in medicine presentation. I plan on going into healthcare, and I think it'll be really interesting to learn about the important role of robotics. But also, I'm excited to be running a scavenger hunt on the Saturday morning. So I hope to see a bunch of you there. And a little hint, I think it would be very good to get your first gear in order that you've collected, if you have any, because I think there will definitely be a couple of things on the list.
Scavenger hunts are a whole lot of fun. Are there prizes?
Yes. Yep, there will definitely be prizes.
Maybe. This will be good. All right. Running out of time here, Samantha, but what are you most excited about?
I am so excited to be a producer on the show. I can't wait to be doing behind the scenes stuff and interacting with all the students, but I'm also really looking forward to our artificial intelligence presentation, as well as our presentations with the youth conference. I think those are going to be awesome.
That is absolutely great. And Pranit, what are you most looking forward to these conferences?
Well, I'm going to make it a point to try and attend as many sessions as I can. Because in the past, as you said, like in person, you can only be in so many places at once. So this time, maybe multiple screens and multiple windows might be my friend. So it's like watching a bunch of events when you're home on the Blue Alliance, but this time it's going to be on Twitch watching all the conference and presentations. So I'm looking forward to that. It's going to be pretty exciting.
Fabulous. Well, thank you so much to Teams 2056 and 1305 for putting on these conferences, and especially to Emily, Samantha, Colton, Michelle for coming on the show. This is going to be great. So everyone, remember, tune in, follow social media, see where you can watch this. But remember, your two main places to go, 1305.org and 2056.ca, and you'll find all the information you need there. So thank you for being on. And now for our next segment, let's take a look at a word from our sponsor.
What I value most about Lakeside and Lakeside's culture is the extracurricular activity or involvement that Lakeside has with organizations such as FIRST. Having a partnership with FIRST is really important to me because I part-time teach kids robotics, and I am an advocate for women in STEM and women in engineering, and kind of overcoming that, you know, stigma or that appearance of what people in certain fields look like. And so the fact that Lakeside has an alliance with FIRST Robotics shows that it aligns their values with my values, and that's really important to me.
Okay, we're back. Pranit, you ready for this?
Yeah, I'm so excited.
It's the comeback of Storytime. We haven't done it since last season. We're going to bring on, you know, the way Storytime works is, you know, we have alumni, volunteers, anyone of that sort of ilk, and we just kind of talk about their first story and their first journey and their history. So going to be really excited. And we got a really interesting character today. He is a first alum from Team 1241, a mentor, a First Canada FTA, and volunteer coordinator, the man with the bunny ears. They're on right there. We got Kaushal Kapasi. Hey, Kaushal.
Hey, Karthik. Hey, Pranit.
Good to see you. And it's been a while because, you know, social distancing and whatever.
Yeah.
Like, Kaushal is just like such a fixture at our events, whether he's being the volunteer coordinator or if he's on the field fixing your robot, or he's just kind of everywhere. And I'm so used, like March, April, I basically see Kaushal every weekend. you know? And it's just like a chill thing. Like, this is like this fixture in my life. And I've missed that. So I've missed you, buddy. So I'm glad you're here.
Yeah, same. It's actually great to see everyone again. I've been following First Canada Live to just to keep up with, you know, what's going on in the first world, getting to, you know, see familiar faces, meet new people. And it's been great to watch everyone on the show.
So Kaushal, you've got, you know, a great first story, just like so many of our first alumni is. So why don't you tell us, just give us like the overview of your first journey. Like how, where did you start? Where did you go? And where are you now?
Yeah, sure. For sure. So I started as a grade 10 student on team 1241 Theory 6, based out of Rick Hansen Secondary School. And I was on the programming sub team. I was on the team for 3 years. I graduated in grade 12 in 2009. I went to UOIT. I studied mechanical engineering and management. I graduated from there in 2014. And then I've been mentoring and working at TD Bank as a IT architect since 2014 as well. And I'm still there.
Very nice. And so that position at TD, like, did FIRST help you in getting that position?
Oh yeah, 100%. It's actually really funny. After I graduated, I was volunteering at, we had a FLL open, which is an international FLL competition where we invited teams from all over Canada and all over the world. It was a really amazing experience. We had teams from Brazil, from China, from India. Pretty much if they had a FIRST team, an FLL team, they were here. It was kind of like that. It was a huge party. And I was volunteering at that event, and I was speaking to Mr. Brenner, who's the president of FIRST Canada, and he was like, hey, are you looking for a job now? He knew I'd graduated. So, and I was like, yeah. And he's like, well, I know this person at TD Bank, and he's looking for people. Would you be interested? And I was like, sure. My degree's in mechanical engineering. This job's in software. And to me,
classic I swear Mr. B has an Excel sheet of every single alum that he knows personally and doesn't know. It doesn't really matter. He just has like, oh, this person graduates this year, so next time I see them, I'm gonna ask them, are they looking for a job? He's just got hookups for everyone everywhere in any company that you're looking at.
Yeah.
Oh man, you've been in FIRST for so long. You've made your way up as a competitor through the volunteering scene, you know, now as an FTA and a volunteer coordinator. What has been your proudest moment? You can even break it up into like two parts, as a competitor and a volunteer if you want.
Yeah. So for me, I volunteer for pretty much all the FIRST programs. And for me personally, one of the proudest moments as a volunteer is volunteering as a head referee for FLL events. To me, that's the best time. I get to speak with coaches on the morning of the event. Just to give them an overview of rules, clarify any questions. But the most impactful part is when I can speak to the coaches and the parents directly and tell them, hey, I'm an example of what this program sort of produces. I'm not the best example. I'm not the worst. I am the average example. And I think it is pretty amazing to see what little kids can do at that age in FLL. And believe me, when they grow up, they're going to be amazing. They're rock stars already. So
for sure, man, I can get behind that. I remember in fourth year at university, we had to make a robot that followed a line. And they gave us the Lego kit. And I kid you not, that was for like a small project. It was like a two-parter. And we had to go through a maze and figure it out. Like, you could be placed anywhere and whatnot. And you had these like third year and fourth year kids, like students, sorry, not kids at university, like students, just struggling with it for like days and weeks. And I'm like, dude, like, I know kids like under the age of 10 who would have been done by now.
I'll make a bold hot take. I'll make a bold, bold hot take that the average FIRST Lego League student is better at programming robots than the average FRC student. I'll make that bold hot take. And because the FLL program is great on so many different levels. And one is like, they really, really push that knowledge in there. And it's so attainable because it's the language that they use is like very simple to get to wrap your heads around. And so it's approachable. And I think that sometimes in FRC, people see it as like, whoa, this is way too complicated. I can't. And so only a few students try it. And the students who try it, they end up mastering it. Like, we've seen these FRC robots. I'm not trying to undersell that. But I think that in FLL, it's, you know, it's very common that like every student on the team will have worked on some programming of some of the missions. So that's
for sure. I think it just like your exposure to the FLL program, as you said, like it just improves like the chances of you getting better at coding. So it's not as daunting when you see like the text, if you're using Java or C++, or, you know, the icons if you're using LabVIEW. Karthik here is our Ontario LabVIEW expert. He knows. So
I do know LabVIEW. Okay, well, moving along, I'd like to know, you know, Kaushal, like we call this story time for a reason, and everyone who's gone through this program has like 87 different stories, but like what is one, maybe your favorite, or is the story that you'd like to share to our audience on First Canada Live?
I actually have two stories. I'll be super quick. One of them was as a volunteer coordinator at the Ryerson event. This was 3 years ago or so. I was, you know, just being a volunteer coordinator, walking around, making sure everyone was good, everyone had had food, everyone was feeling okay in the role they were in, no one was too stressed out. And then, you know, the event wrapped up, we were packing up the field, and one of the volunteers came over, and this girl, she was a high school student at the time, she was volunteering as field reset, and she said, all she said to me was, hey, thanks for, you know, remembering my name, thanks for checking up on me, and that was it. And to me, I was very proud of myself at that moment. I felt that I was able to make a welcoming and, you know, safe environment for the student as a volunteer. So to me, I think that was really impactful, like getting to know someone, even, you know, just check in on them, make sure they've eaten when you're working with them, you know, on your team or something.
I have to say, yeah, it's really neat that you mentioned that, because it means so much at an event when someone does be like, hey, how are you doing? Like just recognizing that everyone is really busy, but like that someone's willing to take some time out of their day just to be like, hey, have you eaten? It's just little things like that. It means a lot. You know, I know like sometimes it's nice. It feels good. You know, it doesn't matter if you were like a first time volunteering or you've been volunteering for 20 years. It feels very good.
Yeah, and especially if this someone, like, if this is their first volunteering experience at a first event, like, you want to show them, like, you know, we treat everyone as family when they're volunteering, everyone's there to put on a show for everyone who's participating, but at the same time, we want to make sure everyone's looked after. So I'm going to backtrack a little bit here, going back to your introduction part where you were talking about, you said you went to UOIT. Like, you know, why did you end up going there? What did you study? Like, was there something that led you to choose that field of study, field of, you know, education?
Yeah, 100% the reason I started studying engineering was my experience with FIRST. And as a student, before I started the program, I come from a family of lawyers. My dad, my uncle, my grandfather, my cousins, I have a lot of lawyers in my family. So initially I was like, oh, I'll probably, you know, study business and then go on, go to grad school, do law. That was sort of my default plan. And then one of my friends, Gaurav, he introduced me to FRST. He's like, hey, come check out this robotics thing I do. And I was like, sure. So I went one evening and I was like, I was hooked. I got to see the robot they built in 06, Aim High, and yeah. And then as a student on the team, I was really fortunate. My teacher was John Hobbins. And he
now, who's that guy?
Yeah, you might have heard of him just a little bit.
Yeah.
But he had a great impact on me. He is a role model to me because he showed me that, you know, engineering is, you know, you're doing cool stuff, but at the same time you're also problem solving. And I really got into problem solving, and that's why I was like, hey, I think mechanical engineering, I think I can do that. And I think I'm going to go ahead and pursue a future and an education in that and get a degree.
Very cool. Kaushal, earlier you said you had two stories, so I'd love to hear what that second story is.
Yeah. So the second story is when I was a student in the grade 11 year. This was 2008 at the Waterloo Regional. I was, you know, a programmer on the team. I was also the human player on the drive team. And during one of the matches, our robot pretty much There was a coding error. We were not aware of it.
Should have had some FLL students help you out.
Yeah, totally. And our robot actually broke its arm in half. And the span of arm which broke was 48 inches long. And this was during qualifying on Saturday morning. We were still regionals back then. So it was our second to last match. And the arm broke and everyone's freaking out. And the mechanical team and the drive team and everyone just went to the pits. Everyone saw what happened. It had happened right at the start of the match. That arm was taken off within, say, 20 minutes. We got back out onto the field to play our last match. We played without an arm. And then by the time lunchtime and alliance selections rolled around, we had the replacement arm put back on and we were back in business. And to me, that was just a sign where, you know, teamwork, preparation, having the right people in the right places, you can fix any issue. It's just a matter of time. And even if people are under pressure, they can still perform.
Yeah, and this is one of the cool things about FIRST. Like, you know, we talk about like, okay, like why do FIRST kids seem so much more prepared? Like once they're done in this program, when they go into university and when they go into the work world. And it's not because they're learning about gear ratio. It's not because they're learning how to, you know, use a screwdriver or grease a gearbox, but it's the teamwork that happens that we're given. Forget about the tough problem of building a robot, but when you go to an event, there's like, you know, refer to like these micro interactions where over and over again, you're given tough challenges that you have to solve as a team. And so you might not even think of them because they just happen so quickly, but each one of those is a repetition that prepares you for the work world. So when you are trying to solve problems in a more relaxed frame, because more often than not, the work world is way more relaxed than what's happening at a first event.
Yeah.
You're ready and you know how to do that. And you might not even realize that FIRST has prepared you for this. And then you're just kind of like, oh, you know, like you just know how to do this. This stuff kind of comes, it becomes second nature.
FIRST is this Mr. Miyagi-ing us, I swear. It's like jacket on, jacket off, baby.
Yeah. And so it's really impressive how this kind of comes together. And like, what you mentioned there is like, I'm sure pretty much everyone in the audience can, who's been on a team can relate to having something like that, whether they've, it's been a mechanical thing, a programming thing, you're in the stands and then like someone drops a scouting binder beneath the bleachers and you've got to like quickly figure out how to deal with this. Like these, we laugh, but yeah. Solving each one of these problems as a team, it's so, these sorts of experiences are so irreplaceable. You know, a lot of people are like, oh, well, yeah, I don't, FRC is not for me. I'd rather just kind of like work on my own and learn on my own. It's like, you can learn lots on your own by tinkering and Googling and doing all sorts of good stuff. But the interaction with your teammates, like, this is just like, you know, a lot of us have talked about this. Like, how do we replicate what's so good about FIRST? How do we figure out what that recipe is? And so much of that recipe is these repeated micro interactions. It's really interesting. So I'm glad that you were able to worry like that. And you know, Kaushal, you as a volunteer coordinator, you interact with so many of our current students and our alumni. And do you have like one piece of advice you'd like to share for those who are watching the audience who may not have a chance to, you know, come up to you and ask you at an event?
My one piece of advice is always make sure that everyone's included. You know, sometimes there's a new person on the team and the person who introduced them to the team isn't around that day. Include them in your conversations. Sit down and, you know, if you're having dinner as a team, make sure they're involved. Talk to them. Learn a little bit about them. Learning someone's name and just checking in on them is one of the best things you can do. It makes someone feel comfortable. It makes someone feel welcome. And to me, that's what, you know, a team is all about. Your family, yeah, at the end of the day.
Right. And, you know, you bring up a good big point, the I, inclusion. You know, and we talk about ED&I a lot, and we're going to have actually members of the first ED&I youth council on the show next week discussing this. And it's really important because, like, you know, we recognize the importance of diversity and having a diverse group of people on your team because it just, it helps broaden perspectives and you learn more. But you don't get the full impact of diversity unless you're including everyone. It's one thing just to have them on your team, but it's another to make sure that everyone's included. And like what you said, Kaushal, like just go say hi to someone, sit down with someone. There's a tendency at these events, like, yeah, like I'm looking forward to being a volunteer at this event because I'm going to meet some new people who have like interests the same as me, people who are like me. And like you identify people right away, you click right away. And that's cool. But what I kind of see at these events is there's an opportunity to meet people who might not be like you, might have totally different interests. And that's where you learn. And maybe you're going to find something that you are actually interested in, didn't know about. Maybe you're going to find someone that connects in this sort of way. And so, yeah, like on your team, you know, there's someone new and you haven't talked to them before. And you're like, oh, I don't really know. It makes a difference to go up to AI and, you know, to do those sorts of things. It's a really interesting piece because I think it's easy to talk about equity. I think people definitely understand the need for equity. And then more and more people are understanding the need for diversity. Inclusion is often the lost piece in that. And it's not about doing, you know, including because like, oh, okay, I guess I have to include them. It's including someone then learning, oh yeah, it's really cool. Like that was awesome.
And that's my experience as well. A lot of times, that's also one of the reasons I volunteer across the programs. I've done FTC now, I've done FLL, both FLL junior and FL, then, you know, senior, so to speak, and FRC. And then each program has its own group of volunteers. A lot of them have different interests, and it's great to see how everyone approaches volunteering for FIRST and just volunteering in general with such a positive and optimistic attitude where, you know, we're here to help. We're here to do the best we can to make sure the teams have the best experience. Karthik, like every time we've volunteered together, I learn a lot from you. I really like those early morning speeches where you prep us, you motivate us. To me, that's great. You have a point of view which is very different. And each person brings something new to the table, and it's great to hear that those opinions and those points of views.
That's fabulous. And that's what it comes down to, like sharing and learning. I mean, like I've learned a lot from like your leadership style, and especially because like, you're so good at connecting with individuals, and it's like inclusion comes so naturally to you. Sometimes for me, it's just easy to stay in my comfort zone. And so I've learned, I see you and like, you're just, Kaushal knows at an event, we'll have like what 100, 120 volunteers and you don't need their name tag, dude. You're just like, you know them, and it's really awesome to see. So a question that we have in chat, and you know, so outside of FIRST, what is something that you're really passionate about or something awesome that you do?
What I'm passionate about, I like food.
I was gonna say, if you don't say food, we're gonna
hashtag bat life.
And if anyone, you know, follows me on Instagram or social media or, you know, chats with me, I'm usually talking about food. I'm usually eating something. I'm usually having bubble tea. I know there's a lot of fans of bubble tea now, especially in the GTA area, Waterloo, Hamilton. And I connect with people over food. I like to introduce friends, family, everyone to food, new food places. So it's always a good time.
Oh, right. I got two follow-up questions for you. Favorite flavor of bubble tea, like full order, like what's your bubble tea order? And then what's one restaurant you want to recommend that we try when we're allowed to go back to restaurants?
One restaurant, I'll start with the restaurant. There's a pizza shop near High Park in Toronto.
King Slice.
King Slice, yes.
Yes.
Let's go!
That is one of my favorite pizza places. They have really great pizzas. And as for bubble tea flavors, I will go with a warm hazelnut milk tea from Chat Time with pudding. They'll only add pudding if you tell them it's to make it warm. If you say hot, they won't give you, they'll say the pudding will melt, which is a fact.
Pranit, what's your bubble tea order?
Dude, it depends on the season. In the summer, my go-to drink, every year, my drink of the summer in 17, 18, 19 has just been from Chat Time, mango green tea, no sugar, half ice with tapioca. So refreshing. I also discovered I think it's the passion fruit one or the lemon green tea. That one's really, really good too. And for the winters, I do like, you know, Kaushal's order. That's what I usually get because he showed me the way.
Nice. For me, it's all about the peach bubble tea, coconut jelly though. That tapioca, coconut jelly. So I remember, I'll never forget this. I was at an event and like, I was so tired from volunteering, and it was like lunch break. So I went up to sit in the stands with a little And I just, it was Waterloo. So like there's the bubble tea place, like right across, the same place I used to go to when I went to Waterloo. So I was so excited, like my once a year to get this bubble tea, each bubble tea with coconut jelly. I'm so excited. And like, just sit it down beside me on the bleachers. And then a kid on the team walking past accidentally kicks it under the bleachers. Oh. And I look at him and he just looks at me and goes, sucks to suck. And I was just I wanted that bubble tea so bad because you know how exhausted it can be volunteering. It's just like finally a chance to have it or whatever. And it hurt me. And I was like, I don't have time to go back to the plaza now. And
you can just send him. Dude, one of my favorite bubble tea experiences was in 2017 at the Ryerson District event when there was a bit of a break because we were dealing with some technical issues. I remember Carson was competing.
Carson Lamb, one of our former lead robot inspectors.
That's right. Yeah. He was like, hey, I see like everyone's like really tired and exhausted. So I'm going to go on a bubble tea run. And the man went out and got, I kid you not, like 18 bubble teas for people. He just went out and came back with like bags and bags. And you could see his like, he was like struggling to bring them in. And I was like, do you need help? He's like, no, I got this. Like one person. It's like getting your groceries in one run, you know? He's pretty proud of it. So that was pretty good.
Very, very impressive. Kaushal, one question for you. You know, you've met a lot of like really cool people throughout this program, you know, as a volunteer coordinator, as an FTA, as a student, as a mentor. Who's inspired you the most?
For me, Frank Merrick from First Headquarters. To me, every time I've seen him speak, whether it's at Worlds, whether it's during kickoff, I have the privilege of meeting him every time I attend FTA training. Frank's there and he tells us and he communicates really well as to why FIRST is important and how FIRST is making a difference every day. There's a lot of times as participants in the program, we sort of, you know, oh, there's a lot of speeches going on and we tune out to what people are saying. And that's fair, it happens. But every time Frank speaks, I have to listen because there's always gonna be something good and he's witty as well. So I love hearing his sort of subtle jokes or.
Yeah, and Frank's story is so great too, because like, you know, he started off as a mentor in this program, you know, and then eventually like became the FRC director and has this like real care. And Frank would fit in completely up here in Ontario when he came to the Waterloo event a couple of years ago, because he just, you know, he loves the team, making sure the team experience is right, doing what's right for teams. And so that's all really cool. Tosh, got some time for some questions from our chat?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay. So one question here. You never really bonded to the team experience much, even though you enjoyed it. This is from Parth Patel. It's not like a random, like, who knows your life and is explaining this stuff. You are among the hardest working volunteers, and aside from the social aspect, what keeps you coming back?
I like to interact with the teams, making sure that every team has the same great experience I was fortunate enough to have. I have to give back. There's no way I'm gonna stop.
That's
fair.
That totally is like all about it. And then on the flip side of that, you know, we all know that volunteering is like the hardest fun you're going to have. It's the hard part. So what's the most difficult situation you've had to handle while volunteering, and how did you handle it?
The most difficult situation. I like problem solving. So to me, when a problem comes up and it's like, hey, we got to fix this now, I'm actually okay in those situations. When it comes to more of, personnel issues, we've had instances where, you know, sometimes a mentor will say something that which is not nice to a volunteer, or vice versa, a volunteer is, you know, being mean to a team. To me, those are challenges where I need to step up and make sure that the team experience is good and the volunteer's experience is good. I like to step in, sort of diffuse the tension, make sure everyone's on the same page, no one's, you know, upset or angry. And if there is any further action to be taken, sometimes you have to make a hard decision and, you know, ask someone to take a break, you know, step outside, go up to the lunchroom, break room, whatever it is, and just cool off for a little bit. So,
yeah.
It's not always smooth sailing.
Yeah, for sure. And as an as a volunteer coordinator and an FTA, like you know, you wear multiple hats, and it's always difficult. As a VC, you have to worry about this like all across the like throughout the arena, throughout the event. But as an FTA, it's even more critical because like, you know, you're in front of the camera, and the volunteers you normally deal with up front are also by the field and interact with the team specifically, not just like the parents or whatever. Sometimes you don't want a student to have a bad experience, especially if they're rookies or whatever, because that affects them like significantly. And it goes back to the experience that you talked about earlier, where there's a high school student volunteer that was just like thankful that you just knew their name, you know? And now someone in a position of authority, like talking to a kid that way, that's, you know, you have to control that. So thank you for doing that. I appreciate that. And as a head referee, we always appreciate when the FTA comes in and, you know, steps in for us, be like, hey guys, let's like take this down a notch. We can go back and deal with this after. So thank you.
All right. We got one last question for you here. And I think it's probably the most important question that everyone's been waiting to ask, but where did the bunny ears start from?
The bunny ears are actually from the emcee Sydney in North Bay. I believe it was 2016 or 17. I'm not the tallest person, and before the emcees can start the match, they look for a thumbs up from the FTA. And I would be running around the field, you know, trying to fix something or taking a look at the field, and Sydney couldn't find me. So she stuck a pair of bunny ears on me. It was Easter weekend that weekend. It was perfect. I don't know where she found them from, but she found them. She put them on my head and she's like, now I know where you are all the time. And I was like, perfect. And ever since she did that, I stuck with it because it's my look now. I appreciate it. I enjoy it. And it makes me stand out. And I'm the same height or shorter than a lot of students. So when someone needs to find me, you point at the bunny ears and...
So this is great because I had no idea. I just thought you liked bunnies, you know? I just thought you liked bunnies, or like I thought that Lisa made you wear them, or I had no idea that this ties back to Sydney.
If she made them, there would be a lot more red on that.
Sydney, who's going to be, like we heard earlier, a host of the, she's going to be emceeing the 1305 Gateway Conferences, and she's also going to be a host on First Canada Live in a few weeks.
Awesome.
So I will especially have to ask her about years as well.
Corroborate the story so we know it's not just him making something up.
Well, you know the crazy thing is like they started like 2016 or 2017. I totally thought I can't remember you at an event without them, dude. Like it's just like it's just the caution. It's like, okay, like Karthik will introduce the FTA for the driver's meeting and I will make fun of the bunny ears, you know, like it's just like the normal thing.
Dude, it's so funny. It's like if a robot's broken down or something's going down, you see this guy like running to solve a problem. It's all intense, but he has bunny ears. It's like it's so perfect. You know, stressful like? Situation. You can't get mad at a dude with bunny ears.
It's like Jaws to a certain degree. You know what I mean? It's like the skin is like doo 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 doo. Kaushal. That's how we're doing your intro next year.
Yeah, I like it. I like it.
We're set. Kaushal, man, thank you so much for coming on the show. And like more importantly, thank you for everything you do for the first community as an FTA, as a volunteer, and just like being an ambassador for gracious professionalism naturally. Like no one has to ask you, and you just kind of like embody all these characteristics. And like to me, that's what it means to be a role model in this community. So thank you for all of that. Thank you for coming on the show. Any final words, anything you want to say to the audience before you go?
Yeah, thank you for having me. Thanks, Pranit. Thanks, Karthik. And everyone, stay safe. And hopefully we get to meet each other next year.
That for sure.
That's all right, dude. Good stuff.
That's right. Okay, so we're going to be back with another Storytime segment. A friend of Kaushal, a friend of all of ours, Matt Glanfield, is going to be on in a second. But before that, let's take a look at a word from our sponsors. back for another segment. I gotta talk to Chad here. Part that was not a mix of Pink Panther and not a Batman. It was Jaws, because the dorsal fin, man. Come on, man.
Can we okay boomer this guy? Wait, that makes no sense. Jaws is an old movie. He should know.
I know.
I don't know what he's doing.
It's like, you know, we try so hard. We try so hard. By the way, Parth Patel will be the host on First Canada Live next week when we have our major announcement that we're talking about. You know, it's good stuff. So have fun with the last story time, Pranit.
I always have fun with story time. I loved watching it. I love participating in it. And I love hosting it.
All right. So let's do it again. We got Matt Glanfield. That's right. He's a first alum Hall of Fame member from Team 365 Mo in Delaware, United States. He's a mentor for Team 4039 Makeshift, a First Canada head ref. And professionally, he's a member technical staff at MDA. Matt Glanfield is here. Hello, buddy. How are you doing?
Hey, Karthik. Hey, Pranit.
Welcome to the show, Matt. Tell us your story on Storytime.
That's right, Matt. So, like,
my,
you know,
story.
Your first, because everyone's got a first journey. Your first journey has taken you across the border. It's brought you from the U.S. to Canada. But where did it start, you know, and where has it taken you, and where are you now?
Yeah, so I joined Mo in 2009. From 2009 to 2010, I was on Mo. But that wasn't my first event. Yeah.
Did I get it right?
Yeah, I was close enough. Well, I'll give it to you.
Yeah, most.
Yeah, but my first event was actually in 2003. My school took a field trip to the Philadelphia Regional in 2003. So Karthik remembers, right, with the totes and the stacks, yep. And they race up the hill and knock them down. And I was pretty young then, but that was really cool. And one of the coolest things was walking around the pits, seeing all the teams. To little Matt, that seemed crazy. Like all these really old kids, like they seemed like college age or adults or something, you know, working on all these machines and everything. That was really cool to me. And Dean Kamen was there with his brand new Segway, some random guy in denim riding around on the newest piece of technology that was really hyped up at the time. Like that was really cool to see, even though I didn't really know who he was. He was just the Segway guy, right?
Right.
So then many years later, 2009, my friend was on Mo the previous year and he told me about it, and I showed up to a meeting and was welcomed right in, joined the team that year and was on it for the next 2 years. And that was a great time. So in 2009 and 2010, we won the Philadelphia Regional that I'd been at before. And I actually have here, I have some buttons from the Alliance.
Positronic Panthers.
Right? Positronic Panthers.
Memorabilia.
And Miss Daisy.
Of course.
But the cool thing about these is they're all from 2002, 2003. So these were actually from the first Philadelphia event that I was at. And all three teams were there. I didn't actually find those buttons until well after my time on Mo. They were just hidden in the house somewhere. You know.
So that's something really that's cool. Really interesting, Matt, that you bring it up. Because sometimes you go through like old first stuff that you have, and then there's like new connections that you see later. Like I know I'll go through pictures from like decades ago and realize, oh wow, that person now is like one, I didn't even know them at the time. They're like in the background of a picture, but now they're like this person I volunteer with regularly, or like they're one of my best friends. And it's like, whoa, that the first, you have this ecosystem around you and like you're surrounded by it, but you get exposed to more of it as you stay in this program, which is really, really neat. And like, I think a lot of people have experiences similar to that.
Yeah, and that was definitely the case. Like I graduated from high school in 2010 and I didn't do anything related to FRC throughout my time in university. But I came to Canada in 2015 and joined a team right away and mentored four of them, Makeshift 4039. And as a mentor and volunteering at events, I really realized like what a community FRC is. Like I had that community in the team on Mo with all my teammates and the mentors on that team, but I didn't realize how much the volunteers and mentors and everything are really a larger group than just the teams or just the single events. And like you said, you know, you meet people that you were at an event with a decade ago and just didn't know it at the time, right?
Yeah,
it's really cool.
And so now, you know, you said that you came to Canada and you're doing, you know, you're working with Team 4039 Makeshift, but you also work for a first sponsor, MDA. So how did you get hooked up with MDA and what do you do there?
So I just applied for a job at MDA. I was looking for jobs in my field around Ontario, kind of in the Toronto region. And I ended up getting a job there. So they weren't actually involved in FIRST at all at the time. They had been in the past, actually, Karthik, you might know this, but yep. They sponsored the first Canadian event. I think it was the 2001 Toronto Regional. 2002, yeah.
It was actually, it's interesting. It was called the Canadian Regional back then because it was the only event.
Right. Right, that's right. So they sponsored the event. They had a team or two that they sponsored, but they hadn't really done much since the early 2000s and FIRST. And I brought, this was a hard thing for me in job interviews throughout my life, but whenever I have a job interview, they ask you for experiences, you know, what leadership roles do you have? What was the time that you had to tell somebody they didn't want to hear, you know, all those questions. And one of the hard things for my job interviews was I can't keep talking about FIRST stories for all of these questions, right? You have so many stories from FIRST, but you can't tell 15 of them in a row to a job interview. They'll think you're a crazy person. Right.
And there's also the challenge of like, job interviews are short. And it's like, you know, you touched on this with Kaushal. It's like, it's so hard to explain the magic of FIRST. Like you put someone at an event and they get it, but to try and just talk about it, it's hard to make it differentiate it from 18 other hobbies that people have. You know, and so there's that challenge, but please go on.
Yeah, so I got, after I started working there, I got talking to some of the managers and went out of the company, and they had heard that I was involved in FIRST, and they said, oh yeah, we used to do something with that. Maybe we could do that again. Do you want to look into doing that? So talked to all the FIRST Canada people who I've gotten to know pretty well, like Artie and Mark and John, and we were able to get MDA involved in FIRST again, and it's been really good. They've been sponsoring FIRST Canada. They've had the winners of the FLL League in Ontario, the East and West champions, come in and play FLL against a team of MDA engineers.
The FLL,
so we build an FLL robot. Yeah.
Yeah, the FLL kids win though, right?
Yeah, we beat one team, the other team.
Oh, wow. Congratulations.
It was actually very close. Yeah.
Wow. Impressive. Yeah,
it was closer than you'd think for the engineers who built the Canada arm.
I have faith in these FLL students, especially like when you're talking about like the winners of provincials, like we're talking about like the Bayview Glens and the Ebots of the world. It's like, I remember I was at an FLL event once, and like they built an FLL launcher. And it, like, it shot something across the field to hit one of the missions. I was just like, what just happened? I didn't even know that was a thing.
But, I mean, I think experience building good catapults.
That's true.
Yeah, I think it wowed some of the engineers at MDA for sure. They were surprised by what these elementary, middle school kids could put together.
So Matt, you know, thinking about this, you've been doing this for a long, long time, and you know, there's a lot of things you get excited about from FIRST, but like, what's something that, like, you know, maybe your proudest moment in all of this?
I think my proudest is probably the 2017 season with Makeshift. It was awesome. We got 5 blue banners, the chairman's award, the first one of the 3 FIRST regional or district chairman's awards, and just winning the 3 district events was awesome. We had a very simple robot that year, mostly made out of wood. And it played the game really well. That was a really, really good experience.
Yeah, I mean, about that robot, I think that robot just like a shining example of, you know, when you think of like the golden rules and FIRST, like, you know, not trying to do too much, just picking a couple things and just being really awesome at it. That's what Makeshift did. Mm-hmm. It was simple construction, simple gear running bot, and 3 regional wins, like it was 3 district wins. And like that was just, and there was a few teams that pulled off that strategy, 49-39. Our youth council producer Mahak, yeah, was a student on that team, and it's just like it's very cool to see that, you know, and those principles pay off in general. So that's a big one. Pranit, do you have any questions for Matt?
I do. Yeah, I was thinking. You were saying you competed with Mo. You participated there. You missed having that close knit group feeling with the mentors and students outside of that. So when you came to Canada, what made you decide to get into volunteering? Like, how did you get about doing that?
Yeah, I came to Canada right before the swap to districts, which meant that Ontario was really expanding, had a bunch of new events the next year, and they needed a ton of volunteer roles to fill. So I think John Hobbins, Mark Bredner asked if I would be interested in reffing, because they were desperate to find volunteers.
Right.
And I said, sure. And like my experience in high school on Mo and even with makeshift is that that's something you do, right? You go volunteer at events. Both of those teams hosted FLL, FTC, FRC events, off seasons, you know, and volunteered at, you know, on season events, off season events, all sorts of stuff. So that was just something you do, right? It doesn't feel right not to do that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I started that way, and it's very rewarding. I've definitely enjoyed it. Yeah.
So speaking a little bit about your head ref role, possibly, can you tell us a little bit about like what you find challenging, maybe, or like you said, it's very rewarding. So tell us about like what, like how it is that way when you head ref at events, when you just ref at events.
Yeah, so I know the segment's called Storytime, and I thought a bit about like what story could I tell as a head ref, and I don't think there's really anything very notable that like any specific instance that I remember, which I think is part of the job, right? You don't want anything notable to happen as a head ref.
That's fair. That's fair.
Reason as a ref, right?
See, I have a story as a head ref. Well, I'm going to say that. No, it's good. It's good. But okay. Go on. But in terms of your head ref story, I just remember the one time. I just thought I think it was your first time as a head ref, or maybe it was your second time as a head ref at York 2018.
Yeah.
I just remember there was just like a lineup at both question box. There was this just like massive line, and I was only there on the last day of the event. I essentially became like the lead queuer for the question box, just like getting these people all sort of there. Because every time like you think like, okay, ready to start the match, I'm like, Matt, you have a question over there. And then you go to the red one. It's like, okay, we're ready to, I'm like, Matt, you've got a question over there. And they say they need to talk to you before this match starts. And it just kept going. But, like, it was really cool because you handled this, like, there was so much like coming at you, and just like one at a time, systematically got through it, like kept your calm, didn't show any frustration, even though you were definitely at that point kind of like, I'm done with it. But you each showed the right amount of respect and everything. So I just thought it was really cool to see.
Yeah, that's definitely a standout. That event was rough for me at that time.
It was hilarious for me, because I was just like,
any head refs, like, the most difficult part is like if someone comes and tells you just before the match is about to start, because you're like in that zone, you're like, all right, I need to watch, but this and this, and then like someone's like, hey, you got a question over there.
Sometimes I feel like I'm both of your like concierge at these events, like I'm booking appointments for you and being like, all right, well, this person would like to discuss pinning, while over here this one likes to discuss G17, which would you like to handle first? All right, let's move on to the next one.
And I mean, that's kind of what I'm talking about too, right? So like head ref, some of the things are difficult. There's, you know, a lot of teams want to ask you questions about why they got penalties or what a call was. And you have to be able to handle that well, right? You want them to leave having a good experience, at least not a terrible experience, right? On the other hand, there's a lot of good experiences too, right? You see a lot of teams and a lot of kids learning and adapting as the event goes on. Like you get that front row seat to the event, and you can see teams learning as the event goes on, how to use their robot, what strategies work, what strategies don't. And you see that every event with basically every team. So that's really rewarding.
So speaking of that front row seat, you know, we touched on this, but like, what is your favorite story? I know you said that reffing necessarily doesn't have this like, but what's your favorite first story? I've been doing this since 2003 as a kid. So
yeah. I guess I have two. So one real quick, in 2009, I was a backup human player, and Mo got invited to IRI that year, which is an extremely competitive event. And our main human player couldn't make it. I was human player. And it was really cool. That year you had to throw balls into trailers that were behind the robots, and two of the human player positions were behind the alliance wall. So it's a 6-foot wall that you have to be able to throw these balls over into trailers, which is a good fit for me because I'm very tall, right? Very easy to reach over that wall. And in one of the alums matches, a robot died right in front of my human player station.
Oh boy.
So I had this pile of 20 balls right in front of me. The trailer's right in front of the wall. You know, you get to throw the balls over into the trailer and you could win matches that way, right? A good human player could win the match.
Sometimes you could win matches that way, even if the robot wasn't dead, but it was just kind of like, just kind of aimlessly moving around. And then two robots would fill it from either side. And like, you know, it'd go up like a tower. Pranit, do you have any experience with that?
The definition of bad bounces was the 2009 year for me and my team, unfortunately.
Well, so anyway, so this robot's dead in front of me, right? And I'm the human player, I'm ready to go. I'm all excited. It's a huge opportunity, right? And I'm just throwing balls over the wall as fast as I can. And I think I missed probably like 80% of them.
Hey.
So it was very embarrassing. I don't know if we won that match. And you know, it's on the field with all the best teams in FRC, right? But luckily that video is not online. Nobody can go back and watch it.
Oh, we'll find it.
We can try.
Yeah.
I'm sure you will try. Now that I've told you it exists.
Yeah. We could text Chris Fultz right now.
See if
he might have that online and all
not
that.
Not sure they live streamed it at the time, but
maybe. I think they did, because I definitely remember.
They might have.
There were some like epic matches there. I remember 148's human player hit these like crazy long shots, and I think it was Colin Fultz or Matt Fultz, one of the Fultz brothers, was doing the game announcing, just like lost his mind when they made the shot. And it was, that was a very fun event, like IRI always is.
Yeah.
So, you know, you made the journey from the US to Canada, and you did your undergrad in the US and you did your graduate studies in Canada. So you want to tell us a little bit about where you went to school and what you took there?
Yeah, so I knew in high school that I wanted to do nuclear engineering. I thought nuclear physics was a really cool subject that I hadn't learned much in high school and wanted to find out more about. And I thought and still think that nuclear energy is a safe, reliable energy source that has some value. So I was looking for schools that had nuclear engineering degrees. So I landed on Penn State. It was an in-state school, so it was affordable, right? Which is important. And went there. I did two bachelors. I did a bachelor's in mechanical engineering and nuclear engineering. And just like Kaushal, I don't really use my mechanical engineering degree. But then out of university, I was looking for jobs. I wasn't finding any that I was interested in for a while, and realized that grad school would be an option, which I hadn't really considered before. And at the time was up in Hamilton and dropped in to talk to one of the professors at McMaster and decided to apply to a master's program at McMaster. So I did a master's degree in engineering physics there for about 2.5 years. Got my degree and then started working at MDA. So it was nuclear physics throughout, and I still do a little bit of that for my job now, which is cool. It's always nice to be able to use something that you've put so much time into in undergrad. Career.
Yeah, because you know, so often, like, you know, it's easy to say, like, you know, that undergrad is great because you learn so many important life skills, and you know, like, you learn how to problem solve, right? Like solving difficult problems as like an engineer or math. But a lot of times, you're not using, like, you know, for me, like as a pure math, I'm not using pure math in my day to day. But the skills time, but it's got to be really cool that you're like you're using nuclear engineering. So like, this is super wicked awesome. It looks like someone has found the video. Matt, Tyler Holtzman has posted a video in the chat. For anyone who's wondering, it looks like
maybe
it's IRI quarterfinal one match number two from 2009. So don't give Ty a challenge like that. You know, he's
I knew someone would be able to find it, but
right.
The point is that it's embarrassing at the time, but you know, it becomes a funny story at some point. You know,
it's fabulous. You know, Matt, you're a very thoughtful person in general. You're insightful. So do you have any advice for the students who are watching today that you want to share?
Put me on the spot there.
That's what we do.
Yeah. The one thing that I like to tell students when they're graduating is to not try to commit to first. in university. Like a lot of the students on makeshift, and I'm sure other teams are really dedicated to FRC and, you know, spend most of their lives January through April doing FRC, right? If not as much time as they spend in school, they spend in the shop. So I try and tell them that it's a little bit different once you've graduated, right? You don't have to come back and mentor. You don't have to try and be part of the team still, right? You can take a step back. You can do the university experience, focus on your classes, focus on the social aspect, which is very important. Extracurriculars in university. And if you want to come back to FRC, you're going to get lots of great people. And then to come back as a mentor, you know, after you've graduated and when you've added some other experiences. And I think those experiences can really contribute to your FRC experience as well, right? As a volunteer, as a mentor, whatever role that would be.
That's such valuable advice. I think because, it's easy when you finish high school to just be like, I want to come back and mentor right away. And of course you have lots of knowledge. You've learned lots, but you can be a more valuable mentor once you've picked up some more of these life skills. And you also are trying to figure out who you are away from the team, because so often when people come back to mentor right away, they're just coming back because they want to keep building robots or they want to keep working on chairman's submissions. But at the time it's like, you're not a student anymore. Like it's not student plus. You know, mentoring is a totally different world. So taking that time. And also university is hard. Like there's a lot to do, and it's just university on itself is hard. So it's like what we talked about, like, you know, building simple robots. You want to just like focus on just a couple of things. You don't want to try and do everything. And you want to be able to nail your marks and want to make sure you can maintain your physical and mental health and maintain you have great relationships with your family and friends. So that's some really valuable advice. Pranit, it looks like we got a lot of questions from chat. You want to, what do we got there, buddy?
We have a Mr. Letaparth610. You might know this guy. He's got a couple of questions for you. He says, Matt, how do you balance your role as a mentor when you're not a coach, especially when you're in the thick of competition, being a head ref and being a drive coach? Like how do you work that at events?
I have my role at events, even though I'm not a drive coach and haven't been too involved in the mechanical aspects of the robot as much, but our current drive coach likes to take his time off between matches to kind of decompress, you know, with or without the drive team and take a break and get his head ready for the next match. So I often fill that role as strategist between matches for him. So I'll talk to the other teams and give him the strategy, and all he wants to know is what he's doing during the match. He doesn't really want to know what the other teams are doing unless he needs to know. He's got our plan, our backup plan. You know, I'll tell him what he needs to know if something goes wrong, what he needs to do, but he likes to have a clear head for matches. So that's kind of the role I fill at events.
That's fair. Karthik, you were a drive coach back in your heyday when you're competing with 11-14. Tell us, like, was this you know, similar to what Matt described?
Yeah, I mean, as a drive coach for 11-14, I was incredibly fortunate because I had who I think is the best strategist in FRC, Jeff Allen, at my disposal, who was, you know, filling Matt's role. And so Jeff just, you know, he gave me the information I needed. And, you know, on 11-14, we pride ourselves on capturing a lot of data. And so there was a lot of stuff, but it's too much to process right before a match. It's just, you know, there's just a lot going on. And so Jeff was just really good at giving me exactly what I needed to know and a plan for the match. And it was just like, so comfortable as a drive coach when, because like there's been times where I've seen other drive coaches struggle with this, where they're trying to scout as well, they're trying to figure out what's going on, and I just you know, go like, okay, like Jeff, tell me what's going on. Or like other teams would come to me and be like, hey, can you tell me about this team? I just be like, talk to this guy, he has all that information. And so the drive coach is seen at the event as like, you know, the pinnacle, like this is they're on the field, they're the star of it. But all the best drive coaches in FRC are so good because they're supported by an amazing strategy team behind them. You know, and Pranit, as a drive coach yourself, and someone who has been the strategy team member before and as a drive coach, and like now for me, it's like, it's the opposite. I used to be the drive coach, and now when I'm at an event with a team, which is very rare, but those times when I am, I'm the strategist behind the scenes with scouts. So it's really kind of cool. And I, from chat, Tyler Holzman keeps chiming in, wants to point out that I had a very amazing drive team. I did in 2004. great driver and a great human player. Ty, you were a freaking awesome operator too. But you know, drive coaches are supported by so many people. You know, strategists,
yeah,
drivers, pit crew, scouts. It's like a whole.
And I feel like the drive team as a combined unit is you could draw a lot of like similarities to like Formula One. I know there's a few fans of that sport in the chat today where like you have like a whole lot of people. You have your pit crew that, you know, raise up your robot match after match, and you have your strategists, and you have your scouts, and you have people doing a bunch of other stuff that enable you and your team and your drive team specifically to perform on the field. So, you know, there's a lot of unsung heroes on every team every time they go to an event. So.
Right, Matt, we are running out of time, but I want to ask you one last question. We're kind of asking everyone, please tell us something that you do in your life that's not robots, that's not first, but that's like equally awesome and amazing. Something or anything you want to talk about.
Sure, yeah. Since I came to Canada, I heard a lot about this portaging thing that you guys do. In the US, they call it portaging.
Just fun fact
for you guys. Yeah.
Dude, this is
that's
like
the reaction I was looking for.
It shouldn't be touching my face.
We're home. It's
okay. But I've started doing that in the past couple of years, and it's a lot of fun. I didn't really think carrying a canoe long distances would be that fun.
Where's the coolest portaging spot on in the province?
I've always been to Algonquin. I don't plan ahead of time for these things very well, so whenever I'm looking for somewhere to go, there's always space in Algonquin and not so much in the other parks. So I always end up going there. But I think the pro tip for anyone who's looking to do it is if you get off Highway 60 to the other sides of the park, it's only an hour further drive and there will be no one there. So
there you go.
Very still as easily accessible and a lot less crowded.
Ontario, yours to discover. Algonquin Park is a beautiful site. Matt, thank you so much for being on the show. We really, really appreciate your time. Thank you for everything you do as a head rep. And if you want, Matt, there's been a couple good questions for you in chat. So you maybe want to pop to the Twitch chat and answer them afterwards. I know some people were asking about instant replay. I wish we would have had time to discuss it with the two of you, but maybe we could have like a head ref forum at some point on the show.
Pranit?
There's always going to be people wanting to know more about that, but I'd be down for that. You know, get all the head refs at a round table.
Let's make it happen in November or December. Head ref round table.
Yes, sir. Let's do it.
Sure.
Let's do it. All right. Thank you so much, Matt. And I guess that's, you know, a wrap for First Canada Live. It's been another great episode. You know, before we head home today, you know, in the news, there's been a lot of stuff going on, and we've seen that the coronavirus cases have gone up in Ontario. And so it's on all of us to be really vigilant right now. And we have to, you know, do everything we can to support our community and follow social distancing guidelines wherever we can. Because, you know, I look at this, perspective of a mathematician, and like every action we take, every interaction we take adds risk to the pile. And we obviously need to take some actions because like there's essential things that need to happen. Like school is so important. We need kids in school. We need grocery stores open, and obviously our frontline workers. So that's going to increase risk. So we have to minimize in other areas. So everyone just please wear your masks, stay home when you can, and do everything you can to follow the public health guidelines. Look them up, they're online, they're available. If you go to the First Canada website, we have links to specific guidelines for our teams, but just be aware, stay safe, because the sooner we can get these numbers down, the better chance we have that we can all be reconnecting in person, because we love this virtual stuff, it's cool, but doing some in-person stuff later on. Next week, well, we got a good show. First alum, he's been in the chat all show long, Parth Patel is gonna be on as the co-host. We're going to have a discussion with the first ED&I Youth Council, which is going to be really important. We have the unveiling of the Recharge Your Bot challenges where First Canada teams can compete to make these short videos with the robot or without the robot to win up to $1,000 off registration or a credit to their First Canada account for use in any program, which is amazing. And also John Hobbins, director, FRC director and vice president of programs for First Canada, Dave Ellis, is going to be on the show for a major announcement affecting all FIRST programs in Ontario. Like this is a big announcements. You're going to want to tune in for that. All the details next week. Follow us on social media to get some little teasers on what's happening. And in the meantime, stay safe, and we will see you next week on First Canada Live. Bye-bye.